again. I would like my session and what I say in the next 5 minutes to be very interactive, and I want to leave you with food for thought. Every single day, you put our television screens on, there's a shooting in one country, there's a stabbing in another country, and there is a common denominator. Violence amongst youth and violence amongst young men has been normalized in the world we live in today. What do we want to do? As we sit here as youth, what do we plan to do? SDG 16 wasn't just another SDG to me. Then 3 weeks ago, I lost my cousin. He was stabbed to death after he finished his final exam in his undergraduate studies by another young man in his class. It left me with questions about crime, peace, security, and the normalization of violence amongst young men. So as we proceed in this talk, I want us to think about that, and I want us to really engage, because when I look around the world and I put my TV screen on, it's not women who are stabbing each other, picking up guns. It's young men, and we need to address this. We really need to. As I move on, I'd like to discuss young men and young women and correctional facilities and prisons. If you look at the prisons all around the world, they're filled with youth, underrepresented youth, engaging in petty crimes, vandalism, theft, assault. But then when you look around the world as well, there's a very big gray term everyone calls corruption. I don't call it corruption, I call it theft. We need to demystify what people have said as is corruption and look at what it's doing to our societies. In poverty, lives and exists in almost every angle of society around the world. And this is a result of theft. Yet we have young men and women incarcerated all around the world in a system that's supposed to be created to be just. However, the ones who engaged in the big theft, and we're talking millions and billions of dollars for development of countries around the world, they walk around and we call that corruption. But we have our young men and women incarcerated, in prisons, underrepresented, and we are not asking the right questions of what we need to do to create peaceful and just societies to be able to realize equitable development. When we discuss youth participation in engagement and policies, there are not enough youth who are involved. When we say policy conceptualization, we say let the youth of the world say what they need and what they want. Let us not be prescriptive. There's been a prescriptive approach that has been used around the world where you go and see what works somewhere and you copy-paste it and you try to do it for the youth. We are doing a big and a great disservice to ourselves. We must be able to let the young people and let the youth have a voice and dictate what they want to see and what is going to be the development trajectory that is going to be able to make us make the 2030 dream be a reality and not just something that is a utopia never to be really actualized and realized. Furthermore, when we discuss the strengthening of existing youth bodies and institutions, the importance lies there. We need voices, and if we do not strengthen these existing institutions and bodies, we will not be able to have that equal representation. We must invest further. As we all go home to our different pockets, this is my first time at the ECOSOC Youth Forum, and I'm very proud and very excited to be here. But every conference I ever attend, I always ask, if you have attended in the past the ECOSOC Forum, I'd like to just see a hand kindly. My question to you, between last year and this year, what have you done? We must work in our own individual capacities, and we must work in our own silos, but collaborate and partnership and be able to see the equitable development we truly want to see. When we discuss involvement in analysis and implementation, we need to ensure youth are part of the monitoring evaluation. And I will tell you, for example, in Africa, when we talk about policies being brought forward, governments will advertise in newspapers. But in Kenya, 9 out of 100 youth read the newspaper. So governments, what are you doing and how are you going to be able to address people adequately? And no, the digital age is here. We must be able to communicate with the people we tend to communicate with rather than speaking to ourselves. We must challenge the norm. Oh, I've been warned that my time's almost done. So just in conclusion, what I will say is this. Julius Nyerere, the first president of Tanzania, had something called ujamaism. Ujamaa means coming together as a community, coming together ensuring we have strong family structures. And this is what we're going to be able to achieve. So let us never underestimate the power of society, the power of strengthening family bodies to be able to realize and actualize the peace we want to see in societies around the world, the eradication of crime that we also want to see in societies in the world. We must work together. We must bring our hands together and we must support each other. Thank you very much.